about it finally. We talk a lot about coding and software engineering on this channel, but there's equally, if not more, jobs that do not require any coding skills, that pay over $100,000 annually, that you can do whether you have coding skills or maybe you don't, but you want to break into tech. Today, we are going to be covering some of the highest paying non-coding related jobs in tech. Before we get into it though, make sure to hit that subscribe button for more tech and coding related videos. Leave in the comments any questions you have or other video topics you want me to make, because as you know, that is how I make these videos. Okay, let's just dive right into it. When I was first getting into tech, or when I used to think of the tech industry, I'd always associate it with very technical roles. And I think a lot of people do that as well, especially if they are inexperienced or haven't really been in the tech industry before. You think, oh, I would love to get into tech, but I don't want to learn how to code, or coding just isn't for me, so clearly tech isn't for me. And it couldn't be further from the truth. Yes, there are a lot of amazing technical roles that you can do within tech, of course, but there are equally, actually probably more, definitely more roles in tech that do not require any technical skills, any coding skills. When going through different roles in tech that do not require any coding, I'm going to be using levels.fyi. I'll link it down below, but it's a really great site and I find it to be one of the most reliable sites for accurate total compensation, for total packages within the tech industry. So oftentimes when I make videos that I reference or refer to different typical annual salaries or full annual compensations, I usually go to levels.fyi because it's accurate and it's very reliable and it has a ton of different data points based on different companies in different locations. And as always, I feel like we need to have a disclaimer here stating that yes, different roles or the same role will vary based on compensation, based on company, and based on where you are working. So these are based out of cities throughout the United States, but if you are not located in the United States, this salary, this total compensation or salary might vary based on where you're located. The first one on the list is product manager. There's no surprise here that product manager would make it onto this list, as it is a very high in demand and popular role that requires zero coding skills. Of course, like anything, if you have some background or technical background, it always helps, but it definitely is not required. And when I go on to Levels FYI, the average salary for a, or sorry, average total compensation, I should say, for a product manager varies from 180 to 160. And once again, that really varies. So for right now, it says MasterCard, for the company MasterCard, is $169,000. Wells Fargo is $180,000. So as you can see, the salary range does vary, but overall, you can easily make over $100,000 with a product manager role. So what exactly is a product manager? What do they do? This is something when I got into tech and I had my first product manager, I was like, what do you do? Like, you seem to be very busy and you do a lot, but I don't understand what you do. When I think product manager, I like to think of them as almost the point person, the key person through developers, designers, the client. It's kind of like there's this like swirl or tornado going around and all these moving parts, and they are in the middle of it, making sure that everything flows together smoothly. Other roles or other duties in a product manager's job would be to ensure that the product planning and execution goes smoothly, that everything runs smoothly, that we are meeting the client's needs or meeting the needs of the new features we are building. And they have a role where you really need to have strong communication skills, excellent planning skills, breaking down problems, and also being very flexible. Different problems will come your way pretty much on a daily basis, so you need to be able to really take different things from both the technical side to the client side, different problems coming at every angle, and be able to not completely get stressed out, but rather take a step back and just solve it. I actually have, and I'll pull up on screen here, a little product manager job description that I found, and I think it does a good job. So this would be something that if a company was looking for a product manager, they would use. And it says here, the product manager is responsible for product planning and execution throughout the product lifecycle, so from beginning to end. So some expectations include defining the product strategy and roadmap. That's a huge thing for product managers, to really define the roadmap of when new features are going to be implemented and the timeline for those. And also another thing that's really important is to be an expert with respect to the competition. If you are going to be a product manager, you need to know what competition is out there, what they are putting out, and just be aware of that as well. The next role I want to talk about is tech sales, and this is a very wide term. So tech sales can range from so many different definitions, because really at the end of the day, a technology sales individual could be selling some really complex software to more different solutions. It really varies, and I think that's why the term varies as well. One thing though that remains the same is if you are a good, keyword good, because there are many different kinds of tech salespeople, you can easily make over $100,000 per year. Of course, with tech sales, you get bonuses. A lot of times, if you sell a certain amount, you get another bonus on top of that. There's a lot of different incentives put in place to ensure that you are meeting your quota. When I go on levels, FYI, for tech sales, now, once again, this can completely range. It says for Microsoft this is in the UK, it is $114,000 annually. For AWS in San Francisco, it is $180,000 annually. And well, where else we got? For IBM, it is $200,000 annually. And this, by the way, once again, this is total compensation. So they are actually including base stock, and they say they're including bonus in this. So I'd be interested to know if there is another bonus on top of this, or if this is including the average percentage of bonus as well. And I'm sure we all know what tech sales do. They essentially interact with other businesses to help solve or provide solutions to their problems. And they do this through selling different softwares for the company they are working for. And one thing about tech sales is you do not need to be a technical person, but you really have to have a deep understanding of the technology you are selling. So there's going to be a lot of time spent learning about the technology you are selling, what it can do, the whys, the hows, the whats, the whole, what is it? What, how, what, why, when, all of the W's. And really understanding it, because your client might be a very technical person. Other times, maybe they won't be, but you really don't know what kind of level of experience to the person you are selling this technology to that you will be engaging with. So you need to come in very technically aware and technically armed with what you are selling. Technical sales is really for anyone who has strong communication skills. You need to be outgoing to some degree, and you also, of course, need to really enjoy speaking to other people. Also, you have to enjoy getting told no sometimes and thinking of it as a step forward, versus if some other personalities get told no, they just get really sad and down and might not be a job for them. But you need to be able to stay motivated even if you get a lot of doors closed on you, because you have to be hungry if you are getting into tech sales, but it can be a very lucrative career. Next on the list is technical recruiter. And there's many people, even people I have worked with before, that start out as an engineer and actually go into recruitment because they maybe want a break from the coding side of things. So they go more into technical recruitment. But there are a lot of amazing technical recruiters out there that actually have no coding, no tech experience. And I know if you're watching this, you're probably like, Tiff, I've had so many terrible experiences with technical recruiters. For myself, I actually had one where the job was for a JavaScript role, and I got on the phone with a technical recruiter, and they're like, tell me everything you know about Java. I was like, I hardly know anything about Java. I thought, like, this is JavaScript. It's totally different. But you have to say it in a way that you don't make the recruiter feel silly for messing up what they think could be such a simple mistake, but for the person who's getting interviewed, it could be a make or break because it's completely different. So I've had both really good experiences with technical recruiters and also some really bad ones. But overall, if you want to be a good technical recruiter, you do not have to have a technical background, but you do need to spend the time doing the research and having an understanding of the different technologies out there, especially for what you're recruiting for. For a technical recruiter, the average salary based on levels.fyi, for example, for Stripe in New York City is $138,000. We have Wayfair, which is in Boston, and that is $108,000. Some places as well for technical recruiters, they will have bonuses or incentives. So if you bring in this really wonderful employee, or you know, you're recruiting and you find these people that are for more technical or very difficult jobs or difficult roles to fill, you will get an added-on bonus for finding those people. The next one on the list is UX researcher, and sometimes this is combined with UI and UX. But if it's a big enough company, they might have separate roles for each. And a UX researcher systematically studies and targets users to collect and analyze data that will help inform the product design process. So when you are researching for user experience, you want to understand who is the target market, what is their habits, what is their likes, what is their dislikes. You want to know the people so well, ins and outs of who you are targeting. And with this information, you give it back to the product designers so that they can design the best product possible for the knowledge that they are given or for the information they are given. For UX researchers, a lot of times this includes different interviews, diary studies, usability testing. You might be doing A/B testing, for example, on screen, if there is a button in the left-hand corner, how does it perform versus if it's in the right-hand corner? Things like this, to some of us, might sound very, for me, for example, as a software developer, that sounds so, it does not sound fun to me at all, but I'm sure a lot of UX researchers think my job does not sound fun. So I'm glad there's something for everyone, but they get very intricate in what they are looking for, and they really, really analyze the finest details, because it is true. These little human behaviors differentiate so much and can make a huge impact on how the product is designed and can almost make and break a product. So for UX research, if I go to levels FYI, let's see here. It is a very high paying one. For example, Spotify in New York is $145,000. We have Microsoft in California, which is $167,000. What else do we have here? For someone just starting out in user experience at American Express, it is $110,000. So as you can see, another role that easily is over $100,000 annually. Okay, let's talk about the next one, which is marketing operations. And this is something that a lot of my friends started out in marketing when I was younger, because it used to be a few years ago, I feel like marketing was like the hottest job to do. If you steer in marketing or advertising, you're like really cool and hip and with it. And maybe that's still what it is today. Maybe I'm just not with it because of my age. No, I'm just kidding. But marketing operations is a really interesting job, and especially when you combine it with technology. So the marketing operations is expected to manage multiple marketing automation platforms, such as the website, e-commerce solutions, review and approve software that we are using, content management system. So maybe you are using WordPress for the blog, for your company's blog, or Shopify for the e-commerce side. The marketing operations person handles all of this. They have to have, although it's not a technical job, you do have to be able to really be able to navigate different websites very well in the back end of things, for especially content management systems or e-commerce sites. You need to be familiarized with a lot of these different tools. Okay, let's go to levels FYI and see what the salary is. Okay. Marketing operations. Okay, so for Stripe, since we were speaking about Stripe, in California, for a very senior marketing operations person, we are looking at $256,000 annually. Once again, this is for a very, very senior marketing operations person, but I included this because it's so great to know that with non-technical skills, you can still enter the tech industry and really make so much money. Okay, another one is from Facebook in California as well. And that is for $140,000 annually. So a little less senior, of course, but still an amazing paying role. And I think it's interesting, the pay difference based on company and how senior you are, and also on location. That really takes factor as well. Okay, those are some of the top paying non-technical roles that you can get working in tech. And I was super excited to make this video because, as I mentioned at the beginning, we speak a lot about different tech and technical roles and how high paying they are and how amazing they are and all of this. But I never wanted to make people feel that if they aren't interested in coding, that there isn't a spot in tech for them, because there definitely is. Tech is one of, if not the fastest growing industry in the world. And being a part of this industry, there is so many different roles and skills required, both soft and technical roles. I hope you found this video very helpful and valuable. Make sure to leave in the comments other videos that you want me to cover. Give this video a thumbs up, and I will see you all soon. Thanks, everyone.